Welcome to another edition of the Voice of Palestine, Voice of the Palestinian People. It's February 9th, 2014, and I'm your co-host, Hanna Kawas. This week we are interviewing Josh Ruebner, an American author, political analyst, and activist. We will talk with him about his new book, Shattered Hopes, Obama's Failure to Broker Israeli-Palestinian Peace. Josh is also the National Advocacy Director of the U.S. campaign to end the Israeli occupation, and we will discuss the campaign's work and objectives with him. Good afternoon to you, Josh, and welcome to the Voice of Palestine.
Thank you so much for having me on your program.
Can we start a bit about your personal involvement with the solidarity work and how did you come to do advocacy work for the Palestinian people, human and national rights?
Sure. My father was born in Palestine when it was still the British Mandate, and so I've always had a very close personal and familial connection to this issue, and for as long as I've remembered having any political awareness and consciousness about this issue, I've just been very upset, disturbed, and bothered by Israel's oppression of the Palestinian people. And as a U.S. citizen, I feel a dual obligation to do something about it, because not only is Israel oppressing the Palestinian people, but as a U.S. citizen, it's my taxpayer dollars. It's my country's diplomacy that is enabling Israel to continue the suppression of the Palestinian people.
So you've been aware of that since when? You've been a teenager, or and actually, I'm not sure when did you start the solidarity work? Could you tell us a bit about that, and how did you start? Because I believe you were with other group that merged with the Jewish Voice for Peace.
Right. I began doing this type of work after the outbreak of the second Palestinian Intifada in 2000 and Israel's brutal response to that. I was certainly aware of the issues beforehand. I sort of came of age politically during the beginning stages of the Oslo, quote, peace process back in 1993. And like a lot of people, believed that peace was at hand and that the Oslo peace process was going to inaugurate a just and lasting peace between Israelis and Palestinians. And I was pretty quickly disabused of that after a few years of realizing that it was a cover not to end Israel's occupation of Palestinian lands conquered in 1967, but rather to strengthen its hold on those territories.
How did you get involved with the campaign, the U.S. campaign against to end the campaign to end the Israeli occupation?
Sure. The U.S. campaign to end the Israeli occupation is a national coalition in the United States of more than 400 organizations that are working to end U.S. support for Israel's apartheid policies toward the Palestinians and to change our country's policies toward Israel and the Palestinians to support human rights, international law, and equality. And I became involved by going to the very first organizing conference, which was back in Chicago in 2002. Mm-hmm. And I've worked for the U.S. campaign as an employee since 2003.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, you said there are 400 groups in the campaign. What's the criteria to accept such groups? Actually, I'm asking because we're lacking such an umbrella group here in Canada.
We have pretty broad principles, and any group is welcome to join the coalition if they are opposed to our country's policies toward Israel and the Palestinian people and want to do something to change that policy to bring about a U.S. policy in compliance with human rights and international law. Mm-hmm. That being said, the groups within our coalition do a variety of different campaigns and strategies. And have different focuses, but what we're all united in is our understanding that what really fundamentally needs to change is our country's approach mm-hmm. toward Israel and the Palestinians, and that in many respects, as long as the United States continues to uphold its support for Israel's apartheid policies, Israel is going to feel no compunction to change those policies whatsoever.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So, the name indicates that the campaign to end the Israeli occupation, that's just the 67 occupation, and the Zionists might accuse you of being, they want to end the occupation of Palestine in general. So where you stand on that?
Right. The U.S. campaign doesn't have an official position on whether there should be one state or two state resolution to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. We don't view that as being our prerogative to decide as Americans. And despite our name implying that we're limited to issues concerning Israel's military occupation of the West Bank, East Jerusalem, and Gaza Strip, we also, nevertheless, are very concerned about how U.S. policy sustains and supports the idea of Israel being, quote, a Jewish state and discriminating against its Palestinian citizens mm-hmm. and opposing the Palestinian refugees' right of return. Mm-hmm. So in terms of addressing those other issues, I would say, ending Israel's military occupation of the territories occupied in 1967 is one step towards a just and lasting peace, mm-hmm. but certainly not the only step. And we very much agree with the Palestinian civil society-led campaign mm-hmm. of boycott, divestment, and sanctions in terms of having those campaigns against Israel and against institutions that support Israel until Palestinian refugees are allowed their right of return and Palestinian citizens of Israel get full equality as well.
Mm-hmm. So I guess that's basically why the Zionists, specifically the so-called Anti-Defamation League, consider you a threat, because you basically ask for equality, and equality is a bad policy nowadays, is it?
Yeah, we're very honored to be put on the Anti-Defamation League list of 10 most effective organizations in the United States working for Palestinian rights. Mm-hmm. It's really a shame that an organization like the ADL, which was originally set up for the very good purpose of combating anti-Semitism, has really become an organization in recent decades that has nothing to do with civil rights, nothing to do with human rights, mm-hmm. but spying on U.S.-based organizations. For example, the ADL put out this ridiculous statement honoring Nelson Mandela when he died recently, mm-hmm. omitting the fact that the ADL actually spied on U.S. organizations in an attempt to penetrate and undermine and infiltrate the anti-apartheid movement in the United States. Mm-hmm, yeah. So to be considered effective by an organization like the ADL that has done so much to try to validate Israel's apartheid policies toward the Palestinians, I think is a badge of honor.
Yeah, it is. And actually, I was researching it. You were also on the list in 2010. As an organization, which shows that they're really upset with your work. But I'd like to talk a bit about their position, because really, in defending Israel, right or wrong, they are libeling the Jewish people by saying all the crimes are committed by Israel, whether are ethnic cleansing or crimes or apartheid. The sole responsibility sits on the shoulders of the Jewish people in general, which is really promoting anti-Semitism. So instead of fighting anti-Semitism, they are really promoting it. Or am I wrong there?
No, I very much agree with that assessment. And the reality is that if the majority of the inhabitants of the state of Israel were Christian or Muslim or Hindu or Buddhist, it wouldn't matter. Those policies would still need to be opposed because they impose a system of apartheid and racial discrimination against Palestinians. Mm. And what's wrong, this is what's wrong with these state policies, not the religion of the people who are the majority of the country.
And really, all we are asking for is equality for all citizens in Israel, in addition to other things you mentioned, as a Palestinian civil society called on people all over the world to do the boycott, divestment, and sanctions. So it's really, you know, basic principles and basic human rights issue. You mentioned a bit about the policy of the U.S. and how it's enabling Israel. It's really, outrageous to me as a Palestinian that the U.S. is allowed to be called or to call itself Anna's broker. I don't know if you're aware of Kerry's speech at the Saban Forum, where in it he says he described the U.S. as the Anna's broker, and he went on to say, that I have, and I'm quoting him, I have spent almost 30 years in the United States Senate, and I'm proud of my 100% voting record for Israel. I mean, it's really sickening. Then he turns around and he says he's Anna's broker. What do you think of this Anna's broker analogy? And what do you think of what is happening with the Palestinian Authority that's continuing really the betrayal of the Palestinian people by letting this so-called Anna's broker to do the brokering?
Well, I think this is truly a situation of the emperor having no clothes. Mm. Perhaps the United States government believes what it says, that it's an honest broker, but I don't think anybody in the entire world believes that other than John Kerry and President Barack Obama. Mm. I mean, look, under international law, when you are providing arms to a party in a conflict, then you've broken the laws of neutrality and declared yourself to be on the side of the party that you're arming. The United States is giving Israel $3.1 billion in taxpayer-funded weapons every year. And these weapons play an integral role in Israel's ongoing oppression of the Palestinian people. So for the United States to portray itself as an honest broker in this situation is not only a risible position, but it also is completely contradictory to the fundamental premises of international law.
I guess maybe should explain a bit about the continuous aid that Israel gets from the U.S. Since its founding, and it's mainly now it used to be economic and military aid, but now it's mainly military aid. Am I correct there, Josh?
That's correct. In the 1990s, when the Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu was first Prime Minister, there was an agreement between Washington and Tel Aviv to lower the amount of economic aid provided every year, and in exchange to increase the amount of of military aid. Mm-hmm. And so what happened was that by the end of the 2000s, all the economic aid had disappeared. It was all military in nature. And in 2007, the administration of George W. Bush signed an agreement with Israel to give them $30 billion in weapons until 2018. Mm-hmm. And what President Obama has done, excuse me, not 2018, what President Barack Obama has done is to say that he wants to extend this U.S. military aid to Israel and give an additional $40 billion of weapons through another decade after that as well.
Yeah, and really, to us, especially the Palestinians, it's not a question of a debate or, you know, intellectual thing. To us, we, you know, we consider what the U.S. is doing is really enabling, and they are complicit in these war crimes, according to the Fourth Geneva Convention and the international humanitarian law. And I just like to mention there are two books, really. One of them is called The Dishonest Broker. I don't know if you heard of it, the U.S. role in Israel and Palestine by Professor Nasser Haruri. And he published it in 2003. He used to be, I'm not sure if he still is, one of the PNC, Palestine National Congress member. Dr. Professor Nasser Haruri. And also another book, I'm sure you are aware of it, is by Dr. Rashid Khalidi, Brokers of Deceit, How the U.S. Has Undermined Peace in the Middle East. So this is a documented, these two books documents really the fallacy of this honest broker, the American honest broker theory, you know, because to us it's always been, if it's not, you know, the enemy, the U.S. is the enemy, it is the enabler of the our oppression and our continued occupation and apartheid and the war crimes that's committed on us. What do you think of these two books, or have you heard of them?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. And I'd say that the analysis that I have in my book about the policies under the Obama administration builds upon the seminal work done by Professor Haruri documenting the policy during the Clinton years, and Professor Khalidi's book, which looks at U.S. policy from Nixon all the way up to Obama. And what was interesting for me in terms of doing the research of this book was really the unprecedented access that the researcher has to the inside of the diplomatic game that the United States is playing through the documents leaked by Chelsea Manning to WikiLeaks, and also through the Palestine papers leaked to Al Jazeera from within the Palestinian negotiating team. These two sets of leaked documents give an incredibly rich and detailed narrative about how the United States continued during the Obama administration to pursue and even strengthen many of the policies of its predecessors in terms of arming and supporting and providing diplomatic protection for the State of Israel. And this is what I've tried to uncover in my book, to show that even though President Obama came to the White House with some different ideas and nuances about the Israeli-Palestinian conflict than his predecessors, he nevertheless fell in very quickly to this mode of providing nearly unconditional diplomatic and military support for Israel, and being, in essence, what Aaron David Miller, a former U.S. peace process negotiator during the Clinton years and part of the Bush administration, said was our role as being Israel's, quote, lawyers. And Obama, unfortunately, continued that pattern, furthering us from being an honest broker that we need to be if we're going to play any role in helping to resolve this conflict. My attitude is that if we can't be an honest broker, then we have no right to try to broker peace. We should hand it over to the UN. We should hand it over to other bodies that are going to be more neutral, more impartial, more fair, more more applying standards of human rights and international law, which we consistently fail to do, and which we're failing to do right now in terms of the proposals that we're seeing from John Kerry for what a framework agreement would look like.
And let's not forget also the voting record at the UN General Assembly last year, 2013. The U.S. Voted against 17 out of 18 resolutions that really ask for human and national rights for the Palestinian and Arab peoples in general. It's matched by Canada, the record. Actually, we did the research, and it's on our website. Canada also voted 17 out of 18. The only one that voted 18 out of 18 against the resolution was Israel, but that's not surprising. But Canada and the U.S. voted against 17 out of 19 UN resolutions in support of human and national rights of the Palestinian people. So this is the record also of Obama. And you mentioned that he increased even the military aid to Israel. Where this leads us, is there any hope with this? I know the answer, as you said on your Facebook, is very clear. Is there any hope for any results from this so-called latest peace negotiations that's going on?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so for a number of reasons. Number one, Obama has put together perhaps the most pro-Israel negotiating team for his second term. So at its head, you have a fellow by the name of Martin Indyk, who before working for the Obama administration and before his U.S. government service was actually an employee of the American-Israel Public Affairs Committee. And on his team, as has been documented by the Guardian newspaper, there are many, many people with clear pro-Israel ideological proclivities. So you have basically a situation where you have the same types of people who populated the, quote, peace process teams during the Clinton administration, during the Bush administration. Actually, they're some of the exact same people. And you have this image in your head of John Kerry sitting at a board and trying to nail in the square pegs into the round circles. They just don't fit. Mm-hmm. And so what Kerry's been proposing in terms of leaks from the U.S., Israeli, and Palestinian negotiating teams is basically recycled ideas from the Clinton administration. So it would mean long-term Israeli military presence in the Jordan Valley. Mm-hmm. There would be a, quote, Palestinian state without any sovereignty over its borders or over its airspace or over its electromagnetic fields, and certainly not access to the Mediterranean Sea as well. And almost all of Israel's major settlement blocks would be annexed, making the geographical contiguity of this Palestinian state non-existent. The apartheid wall would remain, and basically the West Bank would be transformed into another version of what the Gaza Strip is today, which is an open-air prison. And this is all being packaged in a sort of superstructure of mandating that Palestinians accept and recognize Israel, not as a country, which they already did when they signed the Oslo Accords back in 1993, but recognize Israel as a, quote, Jewish state, thereby putting the final seal on denying Palestinian refugees right of return and trying to codify this notion that Israel normatively should be a state that discriminates against its 20% of its population and its citizenry, which is not Jewish.
Yeah.
And this is obviously hugely problematic, not only for an independent Palestinian state, but for those Palestinians living in Israel or in exile that have to deal with the consequences of this type of an agreement. So I think these ideas are non-starters from the Palestinian side. And I think that Yasser Abdurrahbu, one of the senior Palestinian negotiators, has made it quite clear that these are the most worthless negotiations that he's been a part of in 20 years. And in fact, a couple weeks ago, an Israeli diplomatic source close to the negotiations leaked it to The Guardian that the whole point of this, quote, framework agreement proposal that the United States is supposed to put forward this spring is to keep this peace process on life support for another few months, to head off the Palestinians from going to the UN in the fall, and to get past the U.S. midterm elections, and then just let the peace process die for once and all. So I don't think it's a serious effort at all, even if John Kerry believes to the contrary.
Yeah, yeah. So it's basically the Zionist Israeli agenda, really, that they are doing, and like you said, they're playing the lawyer for Israel. But why you think the some of the Israeli right-wing fanatics are upset with John Kerry, and they to the point where some of them called him anti-Semite, which is an accusation lobbied at anybody that disagrees with these this right-wing fanatics.
Right. Well, I think that over the last 10 years especially, Israeli politics and society have become increasingly right-wing. So in the 1990s, part of the 2000s, you did have a significant political segment of the Jewish-Israeli population that was willing to cede some form of Bantustan-type state to the Palestinians. In other words, a state that would be completely devoid of sovereignty, autonomous in some respects, but completely controlled by Israel. This was what South Africa tried to do in the 1980s as well. But today, I think what you're seeing is that the base of Israel's governing coalition is not willing to cede even that much to Palestinians, and that it's becoming increasingly clear that the forces that control the Israeli government today don't want to see any form or shape of Palestinian sovereignty on no matter how much of historic Palestine. So I think that there's being a dynamic created where the demise of the, quote, two-state resolution to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict is only a matter of time, and is becoming more and more clear by the day that Israel has no intention to allow any type of Palestinian state on any portion of historic Palestine, much less any state which we would recognize as a state in terms of the international understanding of what sovereignty means.
Yeah, I think that's a clear, really, analysis, because, you know, that's what's really happening, and that's why we see, you know, even sometimes some of the Israeli negotiators try to show that, you know, these negotiations are going fair, or else the right wing won't be against it. It's a cover, really, also. But, you know, I want to ask you the question that really, you know, always mentioned, and in essence, I'm really reluctant to endorse it, that the APEC and the Israel Zionist lobby, and by Zionist lobby, I don't just mean the Jewish Zionist, I mean all Zionist lobby, including the Christian Zionists, dictate what the policy that the U.S. takes concerning Israel-Palestine. I say I'm reluctant to endorse that, because I think the empire has its reason also in what they are doing. What do you think?
Yeah, I very much agree with Professor Rashid Khalidi's analysis of this situation. When it comes to overall U.S. policy toward the Middle East, it's clear that AIPAC doesn't always get its way, and that it doesn't always control the direction of policy. And we've seen that on a number of occasions in the past 12 months in the United States. So, for example, AIPAC lobbied pretty hard to drag the United States into war with Syria and didn't get it. Israel, AIPAC made a huge diplomatic push and lobbying push to try to get the United States to impose a new round of sanctions on Iran, even after the conclusion of a deal around Iran's nuclear enrichment. And just last week, AIPAC announced that it was not pushing anymore for this bill at this time, because it simply couldn't get the votes to get this legislation passed. So it doesn't always get its way. But when it comes to U.S. policy toward Israel and the Palestinian people, it's still the case that it gets its time almost, gets its way almost all of the time. Not always, but almost always. And that is because in the eyes of the U.S. diplomatic and military and strategic thinking quite simply put, Palestinians are not a major consideration. So it's almost as if it's a sideshow for the United States, where Palestinians don't matter in the big strategic picture that much, and that if AIPAC wants to pursue policies that's going to lead to the oppression of the Palestinian people, then the United States is not going to contest that mm-hmm. as much as it would broader political and strategic issues.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we talked a bit about what's in your book, but could you give us more details about what's in your book? You know, to us it was clear from the beginning where Obama is heading, even before his election. The moment he addressed AIPAC before his election was clear that he's trying to curry favors with them, and he was willing to accept the pressures they're going to put on him. But could you give us more details about, what's in your book, and, the chapters, and also I'll ask you later maybe how people can get it.
Sure. So the book is divided into two parts. The first part looks at Obama's policy toward Israel and the Palestinians, specifically around efforts to negotiate peace during his first term. And what I do is go from a narrative that looks at his early strong insistence that Israel stop its colonization of Palestinian land, mm-hmm. and then kind of look at how he backed down and climbed down from that position time and time again throughout his administration, and why he did so, mm-hmm. and why when he attempted to convene negotiations in 2010, it was a terrible strategic mistake that was destined to failure because of the expiration of Israel's, quote, moratorium on settlement building. So that's sort of the first half of the book that looks at the hope and the promise and the strategic prioritization of resolving the Israeli-Palestinian conflict and the subsequent failure of those attempts to negotiate a peace. And then the second half looks more at thematic issues about U.S. policy toward Israel and the Palestinians. So I look at how the United States provides protection for Israel in the United Nations to make sure that it is never held accountable for its human rights abuses, its violations of the Fourth Geneva Convention, and even the commission of war crimes that was documented in the Goldstone Report in the aftermath of the attack on Gaza in 2008 and 2009. And there's a wealth of detail from WikiLeaks and from the Palestine Papers that I draw upon to show how exactly this policy works. So thematic things like that, U.S. military aid to Israel, the impact that U.S. aid has on the Palestinians, things like that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, and basically what does this say to the strategic interest of the U.S.? Mind you, I'm not really that concerned, but you might be as an American.
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the conclusions I drew from my book is that this is an institutional and structural problem of U.S. policy. In the person of Barack Obama, you had someone in the White House who was the most sympathetic and the most understanding of Palestinians' narrative of dispossession and suffering under Israeli apartheid rule than anyone previously in the White House, including Jimmy Carter. Mm-hmm. So when President Obama went to Cairo in June of 2009 and gave this, what I thought was a fantastic speech, to the Muslim world, he talked in terms that were unprecedented for a sitting U.S. president in terms of articulating the suffering that the Palestinians are going through because of Israel's policies. So the fact that you had this person in the White House with these feelings, with the knowledge that he did of these issues, and the fact that this policy came out so poorly, so badly, really points to what are the structural limitations on any president from changing this policy in a major way. And that's for one reason and for one reason only, because the Israeli-Palestinian conflict is not a foreign policy issue in the United States. It's not. It's a domestic issue.
Yeah.
It plays itself out like a domestic issue, like the debate on guns, like the debate on abortion. It has nothing to do with actual U.S. foreign policy.
Yeah.
And that attests to the role of the Israel lobby.
Yeah, but my question is really, strategically, this is hurting the empire, and I'm not going to lose sleep over it, like I told you, because strategically they are shooting themselves not just in the foot, but in the heart, because once the Arab world is liberated, I mean, payback and the chicken will come back to roost, like Malcolm X said, you know, so, and payback will be coming soon, because what's keeping them in the Middle East is these dictatorships that they are supporting and popping up.
I agree with that analysis, and one of the things that I write about in the book about is about how during Obama's first term, there were the beginnings of a strategic reassessment of how much value Israel actually is to the United States. So, for example, you had David Petraeus, who was head of the Central Command in 2010. The Central Command is the U.S. military command that has command responsibility for the greater Middle East. And you had Petraeus testify to Congress in March of 2010 that Israel was actually acting as a recruiting tool for al-Qaeda and helping to increase Iran's influence in the region. And he articulated four or five different reasons why what he said is our, quote, perceived support for Israel is harmful to U.S. interests. And this was rather the equivalent of a political earthquake in the United States when he said this. And there were other similar reassessments coming out of the U.S. military during Obama's first term. And you could see how this played out a bit in terms of the United States trying to manage its relationship with Turkey during Obama's first term. Now, obviously, Turkey and Israel were at loggerheads over Israel's 2010 attack on the flotilla, which killed nine Turks, including one Turkish-American citizen, Furkan Doğan. And you could see the United States being put in a very difficult position where it didn't want to have to choose sides between its actual ally in the Middle East, which is Turkey, because, of course, through NATO, we are actual allies of Turkey, as opposed to the, quote, alliance with Israel, which is just rhetorical. It doesn't have any diplomatic standing. So you could see that when these interests conflicted, the United States attempted a very delicate balancing act between the two.
Yeah, I think you're right there, and you know, like you said, Obama brokered the deal between Turkey, but it didn't last long. You know, last fall, or even before in the summer, it broke again because of what happened in Egypt, and Turkey and Israel is in bad terms once again. But you know, I don't know if we should be happy for this policy or really, you know, my main concern really is for the American people, because these rulers are not going to suffer the consequences. They have their own money and they could go live in Europe or wherever they want, but eventually the American citizen is going to suffer strategically from this policy. Having said that, you know, I think really what you indicated in this interview is a brilliant analysis of what's happening, and really I thank you for it. But I want to ask usually last question about what can we do to really support the national and the human rights of the Palestinian people and stop this infamy that's really hurting the American people in general. Do you see the BDS movement as part of this campaign?
Yeah, absolutely. And I would say, first to your listeners in Canada, as you know, is becoming increasingly supportive of Israeli apartheid. So in as much as we need to work on our politicians to end U.S. support for Israel's policies, I think you have a similar task in Canada as well. But I very much agree with your analysis of the power, the growing power of the Palestinian civil society-led campaign for boycott, divestment, and the sanctions of Israel. It's something that the U.S. campaign endorsed when the call first came out from Palestinian civil society in 2005. And we've worked very, very hard on these campaigns since then, and even before that call came out as well, in terms of trying to hold accountable corporations like Caterpillar, mm-hmm. like Motorola, like Hewlett-Packard, that are profiting from Israeli military occupation and apartheid policies toward the Palestinian people. So on the one hand, we run very vibrant corporate accountability campaigns. On the other hand, we are increasingly doing cultural and academic boycott work, which consists both of supporting the efforts of academic institutions to call for a boycott of Israeli academic institutions, which we've seen growing success in 2013 and into 2014, and also calling on cultural figures to disassociate themselves from Israel. So sometimes that means getting a musical performer not to play mm-hmm. in Tel Aviv. Sometimes it means targeting Scarlett Johansson, as we recently did, mm-hmm. For her endorsement of the Israeli corporation SodaStream, which of course profiteers from Israeli military occupation by locating their main production plant inside an Israeli settlement in the occupied West Bank. Mm-hmm. And we're seeing, I think, increasing evidence that the U.S. political classes have come to the realization that the days of Israel being accepted as a member of the international community are few and numbered. Mm-hmm. And that this is what Kerry is trying to warn mm-hmm. Israel of. Mm-hmm. He's trying to be their friend, and he's being called an anti-Semite for it. Yeah. But he's trying to warn Israel that if you don't cut a deal with the PA right now mm-hmm. on these very favorable terms to you, you are going to become apartheid South Africa.
Yeah.
And indeed, I think the only thing holding up Israel from becoming apartheid South Africa is continued U.S. diplomatic and military support. Mm-hmm. But we're seeing increasing indications that mm-hmm. not only is Kerry concerned, but Congress is concerned about the power of the BDS movement as well. And just a few days ago, mm-hmm. there was a resolution introduced in the U.S. Congress to strip federal education funding from any educational institution that supports the academic boycott of Israel. So clearly the political classes are worried about this.
Yeah.
To me, I think we're in the third of Gandhi's four stages of social change, where they're very clearly fighting the BDS movement, taking it seriously, and not laughing about it anymore, that's for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and like you said, even inside Israel, there is such a sentiment that if they don't find a solution on their own terms, Israel is going to become a pariah state. I think that's the power of the BDS, and I think we should intensify, the work on this front, because it's our only hope to bring Israel to respect international law, as what happened in South Africa. Just one last question. Could you give us some information about the campaign website, and how can people order your book, which is called Shattered Hopes, Obama's Failure to Broker Israeli-Palestinian Peace?
Sure. For more information about the U.S. campaign to end the Israeli occupation, you can visit our website at www.endtheoccupation.org. And for more information about my book, including reviews, you can visit my personal website at joshrubner.com. And you can also order the book from your favorite bookseller, either online or in a store.
Yeah, so it's Josh Ruebner, joshrubner.org, you said?
Dot com.
Okay, that's great. So people can get more information on this website, and we encourage people to look into this, because it looks interesting analysis of the Obama administration and the continued failed U.S. policy in the Middle East. Thank you, Josh, and it's really a pleasure to talking to you, and keep up the good work. Keep up the real good, excellent work. And have a nice afternoon.
Thank you so much, and thanks for having me on your program.
Thank you.
And that was co-host Hanna Kawas talking with Josh Ruebner. And with that, we conclude another edition of The Voice of Palestine. I've been your co-host, Marian Kawas, and our final piece of music is by the late Pete Seeger, We Shall Overcome, who passed away just last month. Even in his 90s, however, he was an example of a social justice activist that we encourage Canada's Neil Young to follow by putting in the time and effort to learn about and eventually endorse the BDS movement. Here is Pete Seeger.
Montgomery, Alabama.